Shift Happens. You can access this video and this review at LaFelleLabs.com. The first question is asking us about equilibrium. So consider the reaction A plus B yields C. Compare the rate of the forward and reverse reactions when at equilibrium. So we know that we've reached equilibrium because the conversion of reactants into products and products back to reactants, that's the forward and reverse reaction, have equal rates. In order to achieve equilibrium, we need to have a closed system with a reversible reaction occurring. And we know that we've gotten there once we have those equal rates of forward and reverse reactions. So what does the equilibrium constant tell us about a reaction? So equilibrium means that we have a mixture of both reactants and products present. K tells us in what ratio. So the equilibrium constant K is always products over reactants. And then any coefficients will become exponents. So if K has a large value, that means that it's top heavy. We have mostly products in our mixture. If K is a small value, then we know that the mixture is going to be heavy on the bottom, meaning that it's mostly reactants. Why do the relative amounts of reactants and products change when a stress is applied to a reaction at equilibrium? So a stress is anything that affects the conditions of the reaction. It could be something like adding a reactant or product. It could be changing the temperature, or in the case of gaseous equations, it could be changing the pressure. So the value of K is a constant for a given reaction. So if you apply a stress, that's going to cause that K to change. So the amounts of reactants and products are going to readjust in order to achieve that original K value. Only changing the temperature can change the value of K for a given reaction. The next question is a Le Chatelier question. Indicate the direction of the shift for the reaction below for each of the following. So the first one is removing water. So this is going to cause us to shift towards the products. This is because whenever we remove something, the reaction shifts to replace it. So since we're removing a product, we're going to shift toward products. Adding energy. So if you add something, the equilibrium is going to shift away from it to use it up. So the reaction will shift away from the added energy towards reactants. Whenever we change the pressure, this only matters for a gaseous equation, which is what we have here. So to figure out which way it's going to shift, we need to count the moles of gas on each side of the arrow. So on my reactant side, I've got 2 moles of hydrogen and 1 mole of oxygen. That's 3 moles total. And on the product side, I've got 2 moles of water. So if we reduce the pressure, this equation is going to try to shift to make the pressure go back up. So the pressure is going to cause a shift towards our reactants. Next, we're looking at the direction of shift, but this time we're using the reaction quotient. So the reaction quotient is kind of telling us what the value of K would be at a given second in the reaction. So if the value we get for the reaction quotient is equal to what we have for K, then we know we're at equilibrium. So we're going to start by writing our equilibrium constant expression for this reaction. So we're going to do products over reactants. Coefficients are going to become exponents. And in the case that you have a heterogeneous equation, you would ignore solids and liquids if they're present. This is a homogeneous equation because everything is in the gaseous state. So my Kc is equal to 0.2, and that would be the concentration of NO2 squared over the concentration of N2O4. So that squared came from the fact that there's a coefficient of 2 in our equation. So at a given time, we measure these concentrations, and we want to know, have we reached equilibrium? So if I plug in those values into my expression, I get a value for Q at 0.02. Because the value of Q is not equal to the value of K, we know that this reaction is not at equilibrium. As far as which way this reaction is going to proceed, the value of Q is too small. So if I want to make this number get bigger to approach K, we're going to have to produce more products. So we're going to shift toward products in this equation. Consider the dissolving of calcium chloride into water. We need to write a KSP expression for calcium chloride. So first we got to write an equation for calcium chloride. So calcium is Ca and chloride is -1. We have a metal and a nonmetal, so this is an ionic compound, which means that I have to worry about charges. So the charge on calcium is +2 and the charge on chloride is -1. So I'm going to crisscross these charges. And I get that the formula is CaCl2, which means that whenever I add this calcium chloride to water, it's going to break apart into its ions. I'm going to get the calcium ion, and I'm also going to get the chloride ion. But we know that for every one calcium, there has to be two chlorides, so I'm going to put a 2 in front of the chloride ion. This means whenever I go to write my KSP, we've got a heterogeneous equation, so we're going to ignore the solid. So it's just going to be the concentration of the calcium ion times the concentration of the chloride ion, but that has to be squared because we get two chloride ions. Given that calcium chloride is highly soluble in water, what kind of value would we expect for KSP? So highly soluble means that we're going to form lots of ions, which means we're going to make lots of products. Basically, all of this calcium chloride solid is going to dissolve. So since I have a lot of products, this means that my K value is going to be large, because large values of K are going to favor products. So KSP is going to be a big number here because it dissolves really well. In each of the following reactions, identify the conjugate acid-base pairs. So in order to do this, we need to know the Bronsted-Lowry definition of acids and bases, which says that acids lose hydrogen ion and bases gain hydrogen ion. So whenever we're identifying these conjugate acid-base pairs, we basically need to pick two things in the equation that are related by the loss or gain of hydrogen. So if we look at HF, in order to become F-1, it's going to have to lose a hydrogen. This means that HF is acting as an acid, so then fluoride ion is my conjugate base. If I were to flip the reaction around, F- could accept an H+, meaning it's a conjugate base. So then if we look at the nitrate and the nitric acid, NO3 becomes HNO3, which means it's gaining H+. So NO3 here is acting as my base, and HNO3 is my conjugate acid. We're going to apply the same reasoning to the next one. So in order for NH4 to become NH3, it's going to lose an H+, meaning that NH4 is my acid and NH3 is my base. And then in order for CO3-2 to become HCO3-1, it's going to gain an H+. So the carbonate ion is acting as a base, and the HCO3-1 is the conjugate acid. Compare Arrhenius acids and bases to Bronsted-Lowry acids and bases. How do these theories differ, and how are they similar? So according to the Bronsted-Lowry definition, an acid is going to be a proton donor. It gets rid of an H+, whereas bases accept H+. This is actually a better definition than Arrhenius because it can explain why things like ammonia act as bases. According to the Arrhenius definition, an acid is something that adds hydrogen ion to solution, whereas a base adds hydroxide ion in solution. And this is kind of the simpler definition. Acids will start with H+, and bases will end with OH-. As far as both, the relative amounts of hydrogen ion is what determines the pH level, and this both happens while we're in water. Which theory, Arrhenius or Bronsted-Lowry, best explains why ammonia is a base? Explain why. So if we look at the addition of ammonia into water, we see that NH4 is going to be formed from NH3. This is because the NH3 is acting as a base, and it's grabbing one of those hydrogens away from water. So we end up with ammonium ion and hydroxide ion. So when added to water, ammonia acts as a hydrogen ion acceptor, making it a base according to the Bronsted-Lowry definition. What is meant by amphoteric? Give an example. So amphoteric refers to a compound that can act as both an acid and a base at the same time. And the best example of this is water. So if we look at water, one of these H2Os becomes OH minus, meaning it lost an H plus. So one water molecule loses H plus, acting as an acid. The other water molecule, however, goes from H2O to H3O, meaning that it gained a hydrogen ion. So this water molecule is acting as a base. So whenever you have a glass of water, there's billions and billions and billions of water molecules. Some of them are losing H+, some of them are gaining H+. So this is why pure water has a pH of 7, because the concentration of acid is equal to the concentration of base. Compare strong and weak acids and bases. How does this relate to electrolytes? So strong acids and bases dissociate 100% when added to water. This means that they're going to form a whole bunch of ions, so they're going to be good electrolytes. So if we look at our hydrochloric acid here, we can see that every one of those hydrochloric acid molecules has broken apart into hydrogen ions and chloride ions. Lots of ions means a good conductor of electricity. For our weak acid, however, we don't get complete dissociation. They dissociate much less than 100% when added to water. So here I have a weak acid, and we can see that in the reaction mixture that we only have one of these molecules that's actually dissociated. So because there are few ions formed, these solutions are going to be weak electrolytes. What does Ka and Kb tell you about acids and bases? So K is still K. It's still the ratio of products over reactants. It tells us the strength of an acid and base. So when an acid or base is added to water, it's going to dissociate to form ions. So here I have hydrochloric acid forming hydronium and chloride ion when added to water. And then here's a base. I've got ammonia added to water, and I get ammonium and hydroxide. K tells us the ratio of products to reactants. So for both of these, the larger the top is, the larger the products, the bigger the value of K. Well, our products are just the dissociated ions. So for a large Ka for acids or a large Kb for bases, this tells us that the acid or base dissociates a lot, meaning that we get a lot of products. A small value is going to indicate very little dissociation. So this tells us the strength of acid and base. Strong doesn't mean that it's going to melt your hand off. It just means that it dissociates completely, whereas weak means less than completely. What is a buffer? So a buffer is a chemical equilibrium system that will resist changes in pH if you add a small amount of acid or base. So this typically will have two components, and each of those components is a neutralizing reservoir for added acid or bases. So an example could be blood or ocean water. There's several buffer systems, but the two components are going to be one component that reacts with hydrogen ions, and then one that reacts with hydroxide ions. So usually that is going to be a Bronsted-Lowry base and a Bronsted-Lowry acid. So if you add some acid, it gets reacted up by the base. If you add some base, it gets reacted up by the acid. In either case, because those hydrogen ions are being reacted up, there's not going to be much of a change in the pH of the system. A 35 milliliter sample of potassium hydroxide is titrated with 53 milliliters of 0.2 molar sulfuric acid. What is the concentration of the base? So here we know more about the acid than we know about the base. So we're going to start by getting moles of the acid using the molarity and the liters. Then we can convert the moles of our acid into moles of base using a mole ratio. So that just comes from the chemical equation. And then lastly, if we solved right now, we would get moles of KOH. We want molarity. So I just got to divide by the liters of KOH in order to get the molarity. So we can do this stoichiometrically, or we can also do it using M1, V1 equals M2, V2. So I'm just going to plug in here. We need to be careful to watch the reaction stoichiometry. So there's two base to one acid. So I'm going to stick a 2 in front of the acid side so that when I solve, I end up dividing by that 2. So once I solve for the molarity of the base, I get 0.61 molar. It doesn't matter which method you use. They both give you the same answer. It's just if you're using that shortcut equation, you got to be careful if the reaction stoichiometry is not 1-to-1. You might need to put a 2 or 3 or whatever in order to get the correct answer. So if we didn't put that 2 there, we would get an answer that was off by a factor of 2. The next question, we have two 100 milliliter solutions. One is 0.25 molar sodium hydroxide, and the other is 0.18 molar hydrochloric acid. So once these mix together and neutralize, what is the concentration of the excess reactant? So first, I'm going to get moles of sodium hydroxide and moles of hydrochloric acid using the molarity and the liters. So for sodium hydroxide, I can plug in and solve. 100 milliliters is 0.1 liters. So I get 0.025 moles of sodium hydroxide. I'm going to do a similar calculation for the hydrochloric acid, and I get 0.018 moles of hydrochloric acid. So now that we know how much NaOH and how much HCl are available to react, we need to determine which of those reactants will be used up completely and then how much of the leftover reactant there will be. So the great news about this reaction is that hydrochloric acid and NaOH react in a 1-to-1 ratio. So since I have less moles of HCl, I'm going to run out of that first. So my 0.018 moles of hydrochloric acid will react with 0.018 moles of sodium hydroxide. This leaves 0.007 moles of sodium hydroxide left over. So we had 0.025, we used 0.018, so we have 0.007 moles left over. Now I can divide the leftover moles of sodium hydroxide by the total volume. So the total volume is going to be 0.2 liters. This is because we had 100 milliliters of each solution. So that's 200 milliliters or 0.2 liters. So I'm just going to divide that by my moles and I get 0.035 molar NaOH.